Hi friends, thanks for coming back to my channel. I'm so happy you are here. This past week, I've been hearing almost every single person I've talked to say that they're ready for fall. I'm starting to agree. It's really hot here in Tennessee and humid, and that doesn't help. Really longing for the colder weather and hoping that by the time that we go on our camping trip next month, it'll be the perfect cool mountain air scenario. That's why I'm kind of here today, because I want to talk to you about that camping trip that we're going on. It's gonna be a week-long time out in the woods with everyone from our church, and it is what we like to call the Feast of Tabernacles, Sukkot. Now, Sukkot is way more than just a week-long camping trip. That's why I wanted to make this video, to just dive into that topic and to share with you what our family does every year and what it represents and what it points to, because it's really beautiful. But first, I would like to share with you something that we will be taking to our camping trip and every future camping trip. In fact, I wish that we had this when we went on our beach vacation, because it would have been absolutely perfect and very convenient to keep all of our things cold. It is amazing. It is this cooler from Torit. It is massive. As you can see, it's like taking up the whole screen right now. But this is their Voyager 30 can cooler bag. I'm gonna switch to a different frame so that you can look at it a little bit better. As you can see here, it has the zipper top to keep everything inside extremely cold. It's got a little pocket on the front, handles on the sides, different ways that you can hold it. It even comes with a shoulder strap. Great thing about this particular model is that it can fit 35 pounds of ice, 4.5 gallons, or 17 quarts. You can take it on picnics, you can take it hiking, on the beach, camping, which is what we're gonna be doing. Whenever you go on a family outing, you need something that you can trust and know that it's gonna keep whatever you're taking with you nice and cool, and it's not gonna leak, and it's impact resistant, just all of the things that you need to cover in a cooler bag. This is it. Their company promises that it will keep your food and drinks cold for up to 3 days, which is really awesome. You can check them out at torit.com, or I'll have everything linked down below for you guys. As always, I know you're gonna love it. So now, not what I'm taking on the camping trip, but the actual camping trip, I wanna dive into that. So like I said, the camping trip is called Sukkot. We're going to be out in the woods, spending our time in creation this entire week, just reconnecting to the Lord. Some of you might not have even ever heard of Sukkot, and just very briefly, it is a feast of the Lord that we are commanded to keep in the Old Testament. In Leviticus 23, it actually says, "Live in temporary shelters for 7 days. All native-born Israelites are to live in such shelters, so your descendants will know that I had the Israelites live in temporary shelters when I brought them out of Egypt. I am the Lord your God." And you might be thinking, Melody, you're not Jewish. Why are you keeping Sukkot? That's just a waste of time, and that's of the past. We don't have to do those things anymore. Well, let me share my heart with you. I love Jesus, and my Messiah was Jewish. And because I am created in his image, and because I want to follow in his footsteps the best I can, sometimes the things that our family does and the things we raise our children in doing might look Jewish, because we follow a Jewish Messiah. And that's nothing to be ashamed of. It's nothing that we're forcing on other people and judging them if they don't do it. It's just how we're walking out our faith and displaying our love for Jesus. Fun fact, it is actually a prophecy in Zechariah 14 that all of the nations after the tribulation and after Yeshua, Jesus, comes and establishes his kingdom, all the nations will actually keep the Feast of Tabernacles. I can read it for you. It says in verse 14:16, "The survivors from all the nations will go up year after year to worship the King, the Lord Almighty, and to celebrate the Festival of Tabernacles." That is Sukkot, that is the Feast of Tents. You'll see different words, different translations will call it different things, but it's all the same thing. I don't want to be that person one day when every feast rolls around that I don't have any idea what's going on. I want to be informed and prepared and ready. I think in being prepared and ready, we can truly embrace when it does happen and be present in it and understand what's happening. And I think we're given these things in scripture so that we know how to keep the feasts and how we can prepare for the ultimate feast when we are in the presence of the Lord, keeping it with him as our shelter. But the thing about this feast specifically, it not only points to that future time, that prophecy fulfilled, but It reminds us of the things in the past, and that's what I want to talk about, the beauty of remembering the past. During Sukkot, we remember the story in Exodus where God took the Israelites out of Egypt into the wilderness and became their shelter. He provided for them, he protected them, and he led them into the promised land. And later on in scripture, around the time of Sukkot, we see so many beautiful things take place. It's believed that Jesus was actually born during Sukkot, that being a picture of God coming again and dwelling among his people, that the Lord tabernacled among them. And every year, the Jewish people take the time of Sukkot to dwell on those things of the past and to ask the Lord to bring them their Messiah. Not all of them know that it was Jesus, but they're asking for the Messiah to come, and we hold on to the promise that Jesus will come back and will establish his kingdom and will tabernacle with us again and will be our shelter, Israel's shelter, once again, just like he was in Exodus. Going back into Yeshua's story, Jesus' story of when he was here on earth, the question of did Jesus even keep Sukkot? Obviously, that answer is a yes, he was Jewish, but there's even scripture that talks about it. I'm going to read just a little bit of that if you want to follow along. It's in John 7, but it says here that now the feast of the Jews, the feast of booths, was at hand. His brothers therefore said to him, depart from here and go into Judea, that your disciples also may see your works which you do. For no one does anything in secret and himself seeks to be known openly. If you do these things, reveal yourself to the world. For even his brothers didn't believe in him. Skipping down, it says, but when it was now the middle of the feast, Jesus went up into the temple and taught. The Jews therefore marveled, saying, how does this man know letters, having never been educated? Before we continue on reading, I want to put this little fun fact here. On the very last day of the feast, it is called Hoshana Rabba. I have some information on this right here, because when I found this out, it was mind-blowing. But it says Hoshana comes from two words, Hoshana, which means bring us salvation, please. And what happens is this prayer to bring salvation was cried out by the priests during Sukkot. That was what was happening in this passage here of John 7. The rabbis are crying out to Abba saying, bring us salvation. Bring us salvation. Hoshana, save us, please. Their salvation, Jesus, was literally right there within the temple, the answer to their prayers, in the flesh, right in front of them. How amazing is that? We can continue reading now, because he reveals himself as their salvation. Verse 37, now on the last and greatest day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out, if anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture has said, from within him will flow rivers of living water. But he said this about the Spirit, which those believing in him were to receive, for the Holy Spirit was not yet given because Jesus wasn't yet glorified. I believe to this day they continue to do that prayer, and our duty as Christians who have come to the understanding that Jesus is the Messiah, he's coming again to shelter his people, this is a time where we can make that connection for them. That's part of the reason why we do this. Now, what exactly happens at Sukkot? Well, we are commanded to be in temporary dwellings, building sukkahs, taking the elements of nature and making a temporary structure, making ourselves vulnerable, trusting that the Lord will take care of us, that he will shelter us from anything that could happen to us while we're out in the elements, and believing that God is with us, truly, taking ourselves out of the safety of our homes with locks and air conditioning or a furnace. Depending what the weather is like here in Tennessee, it's probably gonna be hot. Going out of the comfortable zone and being brought into the wilderness to reconnect to his voice, return to that place of full dependency, knowing that he is going to watch over you just as he did for the Israelites when they were in the wilderness. A lot of things that I am referring to is referenced in this book right here called Generation to Generation by Yael Eckstein. highly recommend this, very informative, given the perspective of the Jewish people, but tied in with Messiah being Jesus because she is a Messianic Jew. There's a part in here that I really want to read to tie into that. It says, in the Jewish oral tradition, the sukkah is referred to as a shelter of faith. Houses rest upon strong physical foundations and rely upon human ability. A sukkah, in contrast, rests on faith alone and relies solely on God to protect the structure and the people within it. When we are in the sukkah, we are sitting in the shadow of faith, and the walls of the structure are considered a divine embrace. There's so much beautiful symbolism that is rooted in scripture, and that's what I want to raise my babies in. What better way for them to learn about who they are in the Lord than by walking in his footsteps and doing the things he did. People do wonder if this certain feast is pointing to the time of Passover. Why isn't it kept around Passover? The Lord's timing of things is absolutely perfect. In Israel, when Sukkot is kept, it is when they just come into the rainy season. And for us, it's when things go from being hot to being a lot cooler. There's a quote that says, in truth, we always live by the grace of God. The difference is that all year long, we create the illusion that we are in control of our destiny. And so when we step into Sukkot, we give over that control. And we say, God, you are in control. So whatever you have for this week, we trust you. And we know that it will be good because you are good. So that's the heart posture of Sukkot. So we step into these temporary dwellings. We come out of our houses, and whether that looks like pitching a tent, some people hammock, some people rent RVs, campers, some people go into cabins. Something that is not your normal place of dwelling is the idea. And so whatever that looks like for your family, whatever you choose, you would know what would be best for that and for if you have children and just all those different factors. It's almost like we're putting a pause on the daily busyness of life and going into the quiet wilderness where the voice of God somehow becomes clearer. We say, no, we're going to take this week, we're returning, we're going to remember the past, and we're going to prepare for the future. We fellowship with each other, we have Bible studies, we worship, we dance, we cuddle around bonfires and talk about Jesus, we laugh, we play games, we have a good time together, and it's not just a one-day thing, it's a whole week, which is amazing. It's also called the season of our joy. We're commanded to be joyful at the feast. In Deuteronomy 16, 13, and 14, it also says, you shall keep the Feast of Tents 7 days after you have gathered in from your threshing floor and from your wine press. You shall rejoice in your feast. You, your son, your daughter, your male servant, your female servant. It goes on to list all these people that you would do life with and to tell us to be joyful at this feast. It's a time of worship. It's a time of reconnecting to the Father and reconnecting to those that we love. It's just a beautiful season to be together and to build our faith together. One final thing is that in Jewish tradition, the preparation for Sukkot begins the moment Yom Kippur ends. And that is the Day of Atonement, the day where you reflect on the things that you've done the past year, you ask the Lord for forgiveness, and you start fresh. For Jewish people, what they do is when Yom Kippur ends, when they break their fast, they go out as a family and they begin to build their sukkah outside. Sukkot is a joyful celebration of renewing your relationship with the Lord following the atonement of their sins. A lot of times, even in scripture, you'll see this, but he calls his people into the wilderness so that they can be close and they can hear his voice. And that's what I'm looking forward to this year with my family, just to dwell in his presence and to love my family even more and to build these memories together. That's what I wanted to share with you this week. And if you find it pressed on you that you want to do the same with your family this year, that's why I put this video out a month in advance from Sukkot, so that you have a little bit of time to decide if you want to do something, even if you don't or can't do the full 7 days out in the woods. Maybe you could do a couple days, I don't know. But if you feel it pressed upon you that you want to do something to kind of observe this feast and just experience it with your family this year, leave a comment down below. I'd be happy to give you any ideas or help along the way, but I do hope that you enjoyed this video and that you heard my heart on it. It's an opportunity to rest and to reconnect, and I think a lot of us need that. That is all for today. If you enjoyed this video, let me know by liking it. If you haven't done so already, please subscribe to my channel. I am doing my best to post every single week for you guys. Ring the bell to be notified every single time I post a new video, but that's all for this week. I love you so much, and I'm excited for this season that we're going into to see what the Lord has in store for all of us, and very grateful that He has brought us all together to go on this journey together. So I will see you guys next week. I love you so much. Bye.